Hey everybody, we are The Sound. Sunday, April 14th, 6 o'clock p.m. Anger, North Carolina. We're coming your way. We're going to be at Piney Grove Chapel Baptist Church. You guys got to come hang out with us. It's going to be great. Again, that's Anger, North Carolina. Not Angier. Yeah. It's Anger. And we're going to be there Sunday, April 14th, Piney Grove Chapel Baptist Church. Come see us.
You need to know Christ. You need to make sure that you are in Him and He is in you. Because if you are in Him and He is in you, He will protect you from the evil one. And that's what our focus needs to be upon.
Hey, Piney Grove Chapel Baptist Church. My name is Kerry Caldwell, and I pastor Bellevue Baptist Church in Woodruff, South Carolina. I love your pastor, and I appreciate the invitation to come and be a part of your revival services in just a few weeks. And so on April the 21st through the 24th, we're going to have an incredible time together. I hope you've been praying as I have, and I hope that you invite somebody that needs to come and hear the gospel, that needs to hear about Jesus that week, and that you'll continue praying. April 21st through the 24th, that Sunday morning will begin at 8 a.m. and then 10:30 a.m. and then each evening all the way up to Wednesday night at 7 p.m. So invite somebody, keep praying, and I'll see you on April the 21st.
Good morning and welcome to Piney Grove Chapel Baptist Church, where we are knowing Jesus and making Jesus known, meeting people where they are and helping them take the next step in their faith journey. Now, here are upcoming opportunities for you to take that next step by gathering, connecting, serving, and sharing. That you're in the know, let's get ready to worship.
Good morning, welcome to Piney Grove. If y'all would stand and sing with us, He Keeps Me Singing.
Within my heart a melody, Jesus whispers sweet and low. Fear not, I am with thee, peace be still, in all of life's ebb and flow. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know, fills my every longing, keeps me singing as I go. All my life was wrecked by sin and strife, discord filled my life with pain. Jesus swept across the broken strings, stirred the slumbering chords again. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know, fills my every longing, keeps me singing as I go. Feasting on the riches of His grace, resting 'neath the sheltering wing, always looking on His smiling face. That is why I shout and sing. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know. Fills my every longing, keeps me singing as I go. Soon He's coming back to welcome me, far beyond the starry sky. I shall wing my flight to worlds unknown, I shall reign with Him on high. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know. Fills my every longing, keeps me singing as I go.
Well, good morning. We want to welcome you to the Lord's house today. We're so thankful that you've chosen to worship with us on this Lord's Day. If you're visiting for the first time, I would invite you to fill out a Connect card that you'll find located directly in the back of the chair in front of you. This will help us to have a record of your visit and also to better minister to your family. Once you complete this, if you'll drop it off at the guest services card on your way out, I would love to meet you. And we've got a small gift we would love to give you just as a token of our appreciation for you being a part of our worship this morning. Also, if you are a regular attender or either a church member and you have prayer requests that you would like for us to be praying about, you can use the card to indicate that. Just drop it in the offering box on your way out, and you're welcome to do that. I do have one scripture passage I want to read to you and then pray beforehand. If you have been attuned to the news, you have seen what's happening over in Israel with Israel being attacked by Iran. So we want to be in prayer for that. And I want to share this scripture with you from Deuteronomy chapter 7. Listen to what the Bible says in verse 6. For you, so speaking of Israel, are a holy people to the Lord your God. The Lord your God has chosen you to be a people for Himself, a special treasure above all the peoples on the face of the earth. The Lord did not set His love on you nor choose you because you were more in number than any other, for you were the least of the peoples, of all peoples. But because the Lord loves you and because He would keep the oath which He swore to your fathers, the Lord has brought you out with a mighty hand and redeemed you from the house of bondage, from the hand of Pharaoh, king of Egypt. Let's pray this morning. Father, thank you for the opportunity that we have to gather and worship in your house. Thank you for what you have done for us through your Son, Jesus Christ. We thank you that He lived the life that we should have lived, died the death we were condemned to die, was buried in the tomb, but arose victorious the third day. Lord, our hope and our trust is in Jesus alone. Father, I pray today as we have seen in the news what's happening over in Israel. We know that Israel is your chosen people. So God, we pray right now for their protection, that you would just wrap your arms around them. Lord, that you would keep the enemy out. And God, that even through all of this, that you would be glorified. Be with us throughout the worship this morning. May our hearts and our minds be focused solely on you. We love you in Jesus' name, I pray. Amen. Amen. Mike, if you'll come at this time, we've got a few Bibles and baptism certificates that we want to share. So as we call those names out, if you'll come forward, we would like to present that to you for those of you that were baptized last Sunday.
Hope for A. Evan Gillen. Dustin Grimes. Dustin, I didn't know you liked Duke Blue, so we'll just change that color to Duke Blue when Church search is over, okay? No, he's not doing good. Abigail Mills.
Good morning. Glad to you're in the house of the Lord today. Before we speak to the Lord in prayer, let me let you hear what God has to say to us in Isaiah chapter 41, verse 10. God says, fear not. There's two good words on there. Fear not. Why? For I am with you. Be not dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. Yes, God says, I will help you. God says, I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. Let's pray together. Holy Father, we want to thank you that all Scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable. From Genesis 1:1 to Revelation 22:21. We thank you, Lord, that we Baptists have a way of reading the Scriptures, singing the Scriptures, preaching the Scriptures, and hopefully living out the Scriptures as far as total and submissive obedience. Lord, we know that in our worship services, there are those sometimes who need to rededicate his or her life. There's one here today. We ask that in the invitational time that you'll knock on their heart's door and they'll come forward and renew their commitment and love and devotion to Jesus. Well, we also realize in our worship services there may be some who have never been born of the Spirit, who have never been born again, who have never been saved, who have never surrendered his or her life to Jesus. We pray if there are those here today that in the invitation, when it is given, that they will come and say, I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. Though none go with me, I still will follow. No turning back, no turning back. We thank you, Lord, for those who were instrumental, family members, friends, church people, who were instrumental, Lord, in our salvation, for we came to know Jesus. And Lord, help us to look to the north and the south and the east and the west and the countries of the world and to the 8 billion people plus in the world, of whom many and most do not know Jesus as Lord and Savior. And Lord, in the realm of our influence, whether it's at work, in our community, or in our church, help us to be a witness of your amazing and saving grace. And we pray this all in Christ's name. And all of God's people said, amen.
Thank you.
If y'all would stand and sing with us, this is Amazing Grace.
Sing out now. He's talking about his unfailing love.
Above all kings, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You laid down your life. All that you've done for me, who brings our chaos back into order, who makes the orphan a son and daughter, the King of glory, the King above all kings. The nations with truth and justice shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing.
David Keith.
playing. We just sang in the choir how the world tried to keep our Savior in a grave, but he couldn't. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain from the foundations of the earth. We need to sing that again, and we need to understand this morning that we do not serve a dead Savior. We serve a risen King this morning, and he's worthy. He and he alone is worthy of our praise. So let's sing out this morning.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. All that you've done for me.
Thank you. Maybe see you.
So as the Bible says, we know we have all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, right? Amen. But the good news is that God sent his Son for us, that he would come to live a perfect and sinless life and then die on the cross for us and shed his blood. And that blood was used to cleanse us from all of those sins so that when we stand before the Father, he doesn't see us and our sins. He sees the blood of his Son. Shame tried to tell me, keep looking back. Guilt held me captive to the pain of the past. Regret used to whisper, you had your chance. But Satan's a liar, I know who I am. I am saved by the blood of the Lamb. I am free. Yes, I've been born again. I am forgiven. I'm a child of the King. There ain't no shame on me. No, 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 no shame on me. Fear is a coward, and doubt is a thief.
Praise the Lord. Good job, Adam. Thank you, choir and praise team. Take your Bibles, if you will, and turn to Psalm 51. Psalm 51, while you're turning there, let me go ahead and invite you to write down next Sunday morning. You don't want to miss next Sunday morning at 8 a.m., also at 10:30 a.m., and then Sunday evening beginning at 7 p.m. through Wednesday of next week, 7 p.m. Carrie Caldwell will be here preaching our revival services. We're super excited about that. We know that just because we hold revival services does not necessarily mean that's going to bring about revival, but our prayer is that we will experience revival. We need revival, amen? We need revival in our own lives. We need revival in the church. We need revival in this country. We need revival around the world. So we pray that God will send revival. You'll be praying this week as well. Psalm 51. We're going to be looking at verses 1 through 4. If you will and are able, please stand in reverence of God and the reading of His holy, inspired, and inerrant word. Psalm 51, beginning in verse 1, the Bible says, "Have mercy upon me, O God, according to your loving kindness, according to the multitude of your tender mercies. Blot out my transgressions. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity, and cleanse me from my sin. For I acknowledge my transgressions, and my sin is always before me. Against you, you only, have I sinned, and done this evil in your sight, that you may be found just when you speak, and blameless when you judge." Thank you. You may be seated. Before we begin the message, let's ask the Lord's blessing upon it. Our Father, as we have gathered this morning, we do so for the sole purpose of worshiping you. You are worthy of all of our praise, of all honor, and all glory. Father, as we gather this morning and stand before the mirror of your word, Lord, I pray that you will meet us where we are. Lord, as we come this morning seeking a heart of repentance, that you will work that about in our lives as we confess our sins before you, our iniquities, our transgressions. Lord, I pray for believers today, that you will help us to recognize what it is that we need to confess before you to make things right in that regard. Lord, if there's someone here that has not yet put their trust and faith in Jesus, our prayer today is that they will be saved and experience your wonderful salvation. Lord, as we prepare for these upcoming revival services, I pray that we'll begin today, that you will move in our hearts and in our lives. For we pray this in the mighty name of Jesus, our Lord, whose name we pray. Amen. Listen carefully to the words of Danny Garcia in an article entitled, "Allow Children to Cry, It Helps Them Settle." Published in the journal Pediatrics, a study has come forward with a strange suggestion that children should be left for some time while they are crying, for the same may benefit not only your children, but you as well. Strange indeed, but true, the team is claiming the same on the evidence that children get longer and better sleep after crying. It's been suggested to all parents that this kind of approach helps their babies to learn to manage themselves. The team says that immediate comfort to children every time they face a problem may ruin them. They may not learn to cope with different problems in life. However, waiting for some time before soothing them would allow children to settle themselves, and as a consequence, parents face less stress as well. Now, when your little baby cries out, the first thing you want to do is you want to run to them, you want to pick them up, you want to comfort them, and you want to care for them. When your baby cries out, this indicates they have a need. They need you, their mom or their dad. They need you to hold them closely. They need you to speak soft words to them. They need to hear you. They need to be near you in your presence. Now, it's typical for babies and small children to cry out for mother or father. However, it's not very common for teenagers or for young adults or older men or older women to cry out. Or maybe for some it is. But the Bible is filled with example after example of individuals that cried out to God. I think about Moses and Abraham and Isaac and David and Jeremiah and Isaiah and Mary and Martha and the disciples, and the list goes on. The psalmist said it this way. He said, "Hear, O Lord, when I cry with my voice. Hear my prayer, O Lord, and let my cry come to you." Isaiah said, "Cry out and shout, O inhabitants of Zion, for great is the Holy One of Israel in your midst." It's way past time for us as the body of Christ to cry out to God Almighty. It's way past time for us to cry out to the Lord of all creation. Oh, to God, that the pinnacle of His creation, mortal man, would humble themselves, cry out to God, that God would hear our cry, that He would forgive our sins, and He would cleanse us and heal our land. I want to ask you this morning, in all honesty, when was the last time you cried out to God? Personally, when was the last time? Have you ever cried out to God? Better yet, when was the last time that you called on God, that you prayed to God? When was the last time that you opened the Word of God on your own? The last time you thought about God? You see, today, the farthest thing from anyone's thoughts and mine is God. We're so consumed by many other things in life, and the focus of our radar needs to be God Almighty. Our hearts and our minds and our thoughts need to be focused on the Lord. Perhaps you'll say today, it's pride that's standing in the way. Perhaps you'll say, it's sin in my life that's standing in the way. As a Christian, it's not that I don't have a relationship with Lord. I do have a relationship, but I no longer have this intimate fellowship with Him because it's sin that stands in the way of my fellowship with the Lord. What is the sin? What is holding you back? What is preventing you from crying out to the Lord and surrendering everything to Him? Maybe you'll say this morning, you know, preacher, for me, life is great. I mean, I'm serving God and I'm content. Maybe you just need to cry out and thank Him for who He is. Maybe you just need to thank Him for what He's done and what He is doing in your life. I would argue this morning that as a church, as a convention, as a country, we stand in need of revival. It was the evangelist Gypsy Smith was asked what the secret of revival is, and this is what he said. He said, go home, take a piece of chalk, draw a circle around yourself, and then pray, Lord, revive everything in this circle. Where does revival begin? It's not Washington, D.C. It's not Raleigh, North Carolina. It's not even the town of Anger. It's not even the church, per se. It's the people that make up the church. Revival begins in your heart and in my heart. I want to challenge you this morning as we approach these revival services with a message that I've entitled, A Heartfelt Cry. And my prayer is for you to be able to say this morning as we walk out the doors of this church in just a few moments that I've had a fresh encounter with the living God. If you're taking notes, I want to share three truths that are involved in a heartfelt cry. Notice first, it involves a cry for grace and mercy. A cry for grace and mercy. Now the psalmist said, have mercy upon me. Notice that it is a personal cry on David's behalf. He's not crying out corporately. No, it is personal. He's not praying some vague prayer. No, it's precise. It's direct, specifically to God Almighty. He says, O God, Elohim, Yahweh, Jehovah, the God of all creation, the God that made the heavens and the earth, the God that formed me and intimately knows me better than I know myself, this is the God to whom I am crying out. He cried out because he recognized his need for God's grace. Not only did he stand in need of God's grace, so do you. And so do I. All humanity needs the grace of God. Well, what is the grace of God, you may ask? Well, grace is getting what you do not deserve. There's not a single one of us that deserves heaven. But God has given us heaven, and He's given us a relationship with Jesus, not because of who we are. It's getting what you do not deserve. I like the little acrostic, grace, God's riches at Christ's expense. But not only has God shown us grace, He has also shown us mercy. What is mercy? Mercy is not getting what you deserve. Do not ever say to God, God, give me what I deserve. Because the reality is this. We all deserve eternity separated from God. If we got what we deserve, we would all split hell wide open. If God gave us what we deserve. I think back to my childhood. You know, when you're children, you do some really crazy things, right? But I got one amen. But as children, what we would do is we would play this little game called mercy. You would get your buddy's hand, or you thought he was your buddy, and you would grab his hands like this, and then you would count to three, and then you would turn your hands around, and you'd start bending his wrist back, and y'all would be jumping around, and one of you would cry, oh, oh, mercy, mercy. Who wants to play that game with me? Come on. I'm not playing it with you, Chris. Not today. But we would play that game, and we would cry out to our friend for mercy. Help me out. It's hurting. I'm in pain. Let go. You need mercy. Now some will argue and say, well, wait a minute, preacher. You just don't know me. If you really got to know me, I'm a good person. I mean, I do a lot of good things in life. Well, I know what the Bible says. The Bible says that your works and my works are like filthy rags. The Bible says that there's none that does good, no, not one. That there's none righteous, no, not one. And what we like to do is this, is we like to use the old scales system. You've got your good over here and your bad over here. And if I do enough good, then my good, the scale's going to tip and my good's going to outweigh my bad. But if I do more bad than good, it's going to be a bad deal for me. And that's all a lie. God doesn't operate on that system. The scale system will not suffice. Regardless if your good outweighs your bad. David does not rely on the scale system. He relies fully and totally on God. He doesn't cry out corporately, not in this instance, nor does he cry out for another individual. No, his cry is directed specifically to God, and he says to God, "Hear me, Lord, have mercy upon me." He cried out for what he desperately needed. He needed God's grace. He needed God's mercy, and so do you. So do I. Can you imagine for a moment what life would be like void of the grace and mercy of God? I can't imagine. We need God's grace. We need God's mercy. You say, well, I'm a Christian. Praise God for that. You still need the grace and the mercy of God. And I can tell you this. I can't tell you the date and the time, because I do not know it. But there will come a time when the grace and the mercy of God will no longer be extended the way that you and I know it today. So what do? We cry out for grace and mercy. Notice the cry is personal. It's according to God's love and kindness. Notice that he says, I need this more than anything. I need your grace and I need your mercy. I need your kindness. I need your faithfulness. I need your gentleness. All of that extended to me. That's what I need desperately more than anything. Have you ever thought or asked yourself this question? Why does God choose to love me? Sometimes we are our worst enemy. We know ourselves better than anyone else. And if we're honest, there are times we'll say, why does God choose to love me? I can't fully understand it. I'm just being real. I can't fully comprehend it with my limited, finite mind. But I do know this, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. I can't fully understand why God loves fallen humanity, because fallen humanity for years and years has turned its nose up at God and said, God, if you would do this, or God, if you would do that, when God has been reaching out all the while, extending his grace and his mercy. Notice also the personal cries according to God's abundance. Did you know that God owns everything? There's not anything that God does not own. The Bible says in Genesis 1:1 that in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth. You say, well, preacher, if you were to look at this world, it may not seem as though that's the case. Well, the devil is the prince of this world, but that's only for a time. It all belongs to God. The cattle on 1,000 hills belongs to God. So we think about God's abundance, that the universe and the galaxies and the heavens and the earth, it all belongs to God. It was created by him and for him. And when I think about that and the grace and mercy of God being extended, it reminds me of the compassion of God Almighty. We saw this compassion lived out in the life of Jesus in Matthew chapter 9. It reminds me of Jesus looking at Israel and saying that he felt compassion for them because they were distressed and dispirited like sheep without a shepherd. Did you know that there's enough of God's grace and mercy for me and for you and you and you and you and the 8 billion people that live in this world? There's enough of God's mercy and enough of God's grace. But the only one that can grant you That great grace and mercy is God Almighty. I can't give it to you. I can tell you about it, and I can proclaim the truth of God's word, but only God can give you grace and mercy. He extended it to you, not because you were good enough to earn it, but because you desperately needed it. And David says, I understand this. Now I recognize this. Have mercy upon me, O God, according to your love and kindness, according to the multitude of your tender mercies. We need God's grace and mercy. But notice, secondly, this heartfelt cry requires that, but it also requires a cry for cleansing. Look at verse 1, the latter part of verse 1, and follow me into verse 2. Blot out my transgressions, wash me thoroughly from my iniquity, and cleanse me from my sin. So we see the need for David's cry. The psalmist not only needed the grace and mercy of God, he needed to be cleansed as well. What did he need cleansing from? He needed cleansing from sin. David was confronted by the prophet Nathan that told him that he had despised the Lord's commandment, that he had done evil in God's sight. You say, well, what in the world did David do that was so bad? Well, the Bible says that he committed adultery with Bathsheba. The Bible says that not only did he do that, that he murdered her husband Uriah the Hittite. And if that wasn't enough, he tried to cover up his sin and what he had done. And it's believed that this psalm, Psalm 51, was written during the time of that event. David would also record these words in 2 Samuel 12:13. He would say to the Lord, I have sinned against you. I've sinned against the Lord. So David needed God's cleansing. That's the need for David's cry. How does that apply to us today? Well, there's a need for your cry as well. It would be easy to look at what David did, and it would be easy to say, you know, well, I've never committed adultery, and I've never murdered anyone. I can't believe he would do something so low as that. And I would say to you, oh wait a minute. Jesus said, you've heard that it was said of those of old, you shall not commit adultery. But I say to you that whoever looks at a woman or a man to lust for her has already committed adultery with her in his heart. Ouch! I'm guilty, Lord. I've sinned against you. I've committed adultery in my heart. But I've never murdered anybody. Oh, wait. Jesus continues. He said, you've heard that it was said of those of old, you shall not murder. But I say to you, listen to this, whoever is angry with his brother without a cause shall be in danger of the judgment. Ouch. I'm 0 for 2. And here's what we do. Here's the reality. What we do is we say, well, my sin is not as bad as his sin. I've done this, but I've never done that. And we begin to categorize it. And then you know what we're trying to do? We're trying to justify it. But here's what the Bible says. The Bible says, if you've committed one sin, it's as though you've committed them all. Did you know it only took one sin to put Jesus on the cross? And I believe this with all of my heart. If I was the only person living, that God would have still sent Jesus to die for me. Just one sin. What is sin? Sin is anything you say, think, or do that's displeasing to God. I could have given you a real life example of it yesterday. I started to use the bow and the arrow, but last night we went axe throwing. You're trying to throw the axe at the bullseye, And a lot of times I came up short. That's missing the mark. That's sin. So what we say, think, or do that's displeasing to God. And the reality is this, that sin separates us from a holy, righteous God. The relationship that man once had with God is severed because of sin. That happened way back in the Garden of Eden. Adam and Eve willfully chose to disobey God. Paul says it this way in Romans, just as though sin entered the world through one man, thus death has spread to all. That's you and that's me. The Bible says all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. That's Romans 3:23. And the Bible says in Romans 6:23 that the wages of sin is death. But I love verses like Romans 5:8. That's the bad news. Romans 5:8 is the good news. While we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Hallelujah! While I was walking up to my eyeballs in sin, God the Father sent His Son Jesus to die for me. And yes, the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Y'all were watching me right there, weren't you? You were saying the preacher is fixing to fall right off the stage. That's exactly what we do with sin. I did that for a purpose. Because if this is sin, this is what we do. We see just how close we can get to it without falling into it. And you know what the Bible tells us to do? Flee! Run away from it! Yes, the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. And the Bible says if you'll confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, believe in your heart that God raised Him from the dead, you shall be saved. For with the mouth, confession is made unto salvation. And with the heart, one believes unto righteousness. We need to cry out to God and ask God to cleanse us from our sin. Notice the words blot out. Blot it out. It's like taking white out over ink, blotting it out. He says, blot out my transgressions. Wash me from what? My iniquity. Then he says, cleanse me from my sin. Not once, he repeats it three different times. He understood the magnitude of his sin. What on earth can wash away your sins? What can cleanse you of your sin? Well, I'm thankful for Robert Lowry and the words he penned in 1876. What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Could it be this morning that you just need a first-time cleansing? Between you and the Lord, that you just say this morning, you know, Lord, I just need a relationship with you. I need you to cleanse me of my sin. I want to turn from my sin and I want to trust you with my life. Maybe that's where you are today. There's no better time to say yes to Jesus than right now, though. The Bible says, do not harden your heart. Do not delay. Today is the day of salvation. Or maybe you're here this morning and you say, preacher, I'm a Christian and I don't need a first-time cleansing. But if I'm honest between me and the Lord, I need a fresh cleansing. Just a fresh cleansing. I've got a verse for you. You ready? You got to write this one down. 1 John 1:9. As I was thinking about this morning, I lost my train of thought with the illustration that came to mind. Y'all remember years ago the phones that we had with cords? I mean, you'd answer the phone in this room and everybody would be in this room and you'd say, I'm going to go to the other. You would drag the cord. You'd run over here to the other side. You'd have a 30-foot cord, and you'd be pulling it, getting the tangles out of it. Hey, I'm here. How you doing? Let me shut the door. Right? But thinking about that phone, what else I was reminded of is you remember on those touch-tone phones, you'd have the memory slots. M1, M2, M3, right? You could push M1 and dial the number. I mean, back during those days, we knew people's number. 919-553-4182. That was my home number, right? Now you ask somebody there, "Hey man, what's your number?" Well, I hope we don't have to call you. But on memory one, you would have programmed 1 John 1:9. If I confess my sins, God is faithful and just to forgive me and to cleanse me from all unrighteousness. Isn't that good? Praise God. So we need a first-time cleansing if you've never been saved. Fresh cleansing for those of us who were in Christ. I can't think of anybody who would not say, "Well, you know, I could use a fresh cleansing," right? It's like kids again. I think about children. They'll play outside for days, weeks. "Hey, son, when was the last time you bathed?" "Well, I think it was about 3 weeks ago." This is no joke. I love teens. I do. I work with students in student ministry for 12 years. And some of it was with groups we took right here. We would go down to Port Caswell. It's a wonderful place. And some of those guys would be getting ready to go to the auditorium for worship. And they'd go in there and they'd take the can of Axe. Y'all have seen that, the spray. Son, they'd be in there like, whoosh, 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 whoosh. Good. When are you going to bathe? Not today. But so often, we need a fresh cleansing. And God can cleanse us. He can forgive us. I want you to think about the magnitude of this. You with me? Follow me for just a moment. Think about the magnitude of this and how this has changed from the Old Testament to the New Testament. In the Old Testament, the high priest would offer a sacrifice once a year in the Holy of Holies within the temple. Bring a lamb to be sacrificed. A live animal, and sacrifice that animal for his sins and for the sins of the people. And we know what we just celebrated a few weeks ago with Jesus dying on the cross as the sacrifice for our sins, being buried in the tomb and resurrected from the grave. Listen to what the writer of Hebrews says concerning that. "I'm thankful for the Old Testament sacrificial system. I'm thankful that I don't live under that now, but we've got a picture of that and what that represented." And listen to what the writer of Hebrews says in Hebrews chapter 10, verses 11 to 14. Follow this. He says, "Every priest stands ministering daily and offering repeatedly," that's over and over and over and over, "the same sacrifices which can never take away sins. But this man," that's Jesus, "this man, after he had offered one sacrifice for sins forever," that's your sins past, present, and future, "forever, he sat down at the right hand of God, from that time waiting till his enemies are made his footstool. For by one offering he has perfected forever those who are being sanctified." As believers, we're in this process theologically known as sanctification, and all that is this. Every day you're becoming less like yourself and more like Jesus. Write this down, John 3:30. John summarized it best this way. This is a wonderful verse for us to think through and for us to apply. John said that he must increase and I must decrease. That's it. From the moment you come to know Jesus until you die and go to be with the Lord, or until the Lord returns, you're in the process known as sanctification, and every day your goal is to become less like yourself and more like Jesus. And I'm just going to be real with you for a moment. The more I walk with Jesus, the longer I walk with Jesus, the closer I try to walk with Jesus, I recognize just how wretched I am. And I don't need the grace and the mercy of God day by day, not one day at a time, sweet Jesus. I need it moment by moment. Because I know my flesh. And I know what Paul said in Galatians, that you walk by either the lust of the flesh or by the fruit of the Spirit, and you can't do those simultaneously. So we've got to walk by the Spirit day in and day out, praising God, thanking Him that He has cleansed us, that He has extended His grace and His mercy to us. That's a part of this heartfelt cry. Does it include emotions and all getting all worked up and tears? It may. It doesn't necessarily have to. It may be something as simple as just saying, Lord, forgive me for sinning against you. And call it what it is. Forgive me, Lord, for looking lustfully. Forgive me for lying. Forgive me for cheating and for stealing and for cutting people off on I-40 or fussing at people who were in front of me in line when my cheeseburger isn't ready in 15 seconds. I mean, whatever it is, it's us recognizing who we are apart from Christ. That we live in a rotten, sin-sick world, and we're part of the problem. So a heartfelt cry involves a cry for grace and mercy. It involves a cry for cleansing. But notice thirdly, it involves a cry for forgiveness. Look at what he says in verse 3, "For I, not they or them, I acknowledge my transgressions." You can think of those as being simultaneous transgressions and iniquity and sin as being synonyms. But notice what he says, "I acknowledge my transgressions and my sin is always before me." And notice verse 4, he says, "Against you, you only," that's God, "against you, God, against you only have I sinned." So I want you to see what David does here. There's an acknowledgement of who sinned. He doesn't say it's he or him, or he doesn't say that it's they or them. No, he says, I take ownership of my sin. I've sinned against you. I take responsibility. But notice also, there's acknowledgement of who he sinned against. It's against you, God. Ultimately, I've sinned against you, my Creator. And then he acknowledges the devastation that comes from sin. Sin in God's sight is evil. Look at what he says here. Verse 4. "Not only have I sinned, I have done this evil in your sight." So he equates sin, transgressions, iniquity, and sin as being evil in the sight of God. Did you know there's not going to be sin in heaven? Hallelujah. Thank the Lord for that. There's enough of it down here. But he acknowledges the devastation that comes from sin. Someone once said that sin will take you farther than you want to go, keep you longer than you want to stay, and cost you more than you want to pay. It's vile and hideous and disgusting and cannot enter the presence of God. And if that's the case, boy, are we in trouble. What do we do? We run to Jesus. We fall at the feet of Jesus. We confess our sin to Jesus. Notice what he says in verse 3. He says, "My sin is always before me." So it's as though David said, you know, if I look out in front of me here, I see my sin. If I look to the left, I see my sin. If I turn to the right, my sin is there. If I look behind me, my sin is right there. What in the world am I going to, what am I going to do? Where am I going to turn? Well, praise God, he could look up, couldn't he? He looked up to the Lord. Where could I go? Where could I go but to the Lord, right? Praise God. We can turn to the Lord. Don't think you're hiding anything from God. We like to do that. That's what the Bible says in Hebrews 4:12, that the Word of God is living, powerful, sharper than any two-edged sword, able to pierce and penetrate to the depths of the soul, to the joints and the marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. What did Jesus say? It's not necessarily what comes out of the mouth that's bad, what comes out of the mouth is actually what's in the heart. Right? You have a foul mouth not because your mouth is dirty, your heart is dirty. We sin because our heart is dirty and it needs to be clean. It needs to be cleansed. I'm thankful for repentance. What is repentance? It's a 180-degree turn. We're sinning. We say, Lord, I'm not sinning anymore. I'm going to turn to you and trust you. Forgive me of my sin. Cleanse me. Does it mean you're going to live a perfect life? Absolutely not. But it means that there's not going to be the continual, habitual pattern of sin. Doesn't mean you're not going to make mistakes. Say things you shouldn't say or do things you shouldn't do. It's not what it means. It means that you're on a new course. You're on a new railway. You're following Jesus and you're pursuing Him. And the Bible tells us that one day we'll stand before God in judgment. For those who receive Christ, we'll stand at the great white judgment seat of Christ. For those who are in Christ, the judgment seat of Christ, there we'll receive rewards based on what we did in our service to the Lord from the time we came to know Jesus or until we died and went to be with Him or until He returned. That's at the judgment seat of Christ. But for those who reject Jesus in this life, the Bible says that they'll appear before the great white throne judgment. There they'll pay for their deeds and be thrown into the lake of fire with Satan and his angels for all eternity. We wouldn't wish that on our worst enemy. That's why I'm thankful for passages like John 3:16, for God so loved the world. And also that 1 Peter, that it's His desire that none perish, but that all come to repentance. What do we need? Well, I think we need a heartfelt cry. It involves a cry for grace and mercy. It involves a cry for cleansing and a cry for forgiveness. It may be a first-time cleansing, asking Jesus to come into your life and to save you and to put you on a new course, on a new track. Adrian Rogers once said this. He said, nobody is so good they don't need to be saved, and nobody so bad that they can't be saved. God wants everybody to be saved. Anyone who calls upon Him will be saved. Amen. Where are you this morning? As we think about our revival services that are coming up, I hope that you've made plans to be here for that. Revival is for the people of God. But also through revival, not only do we want to see spiritual growth in our lives, and that's a lifelong process, we want to see people come to know Jesus as Lord and Savior. So if you have friends or neighbors or family, invite them to our revival services. And be in prayer this week for Kerry, as he'll be sharing next week, beginning Sunday. And be in prayer just for us as the body of Christ, that God will just stir our hearts and that we'll understand who God is and who we are in Christ and the mission and the vision He's given us. Stand if you will, heads bowed and eyes closed. As our musicians come and we enter our time of invitation, this is the part of the service where you get to respond to how God may be moving in your heart. If He's impressed upon your heart that you need to be saved, now's the time for you to say, I want to be saved, Lord. I want to trust you. You say, preacher, I don't even know where to begin. You just walk down and meet me down front here and say, Jesus, and I'll know what you're talking about. Maybe you're here and you're a Christian, and God's been working in your heart through the message this morning, and you say, well, Lord, if I'm honest, I need a fresh cleansing. What do I need to do? Well, you can do business with God right where you are, or you can come down to an old-fashioned altar and just kneel down and say, Lord, forgive me of X, Y, or Z, or whatever it is, and cleanse me of that. And as we enter into these revival services, I want to have a clean slate, and I want to follow you in faith and obedience. Maybe you've been visiting for a while, and you're ready to make Piney Grove your church home. We'll receive you in any way that Baptists receive members. Or maybe you saw the baptism service last week, and you said, hey, I need to be baptized. I need to follow through. You come as God leads. Father, thank you for your word this morning as we enter this season of revival. We call them our spring revival services, knowing that it's not anything magical about these services, Lord, but we pray that you will just move in our hearts, that you will stir our hearts, that the coals will be stirred and that the fire will be reignited, that we will understand who we are in Christ and the mission and the vision that you've given us as a church and as individuals to make this known to those around us. Lord, maybe there are those here today that need to be saved. I pray that they'll take the first step, Lord, knowing that you'll lead them the rest of the way. And for those, Lord, who just need to come and pray, I pray that they'll move as your Spirit leads. And Lord, we pray during this invitation time that we'll get out of the way and that the Spirit of God will do what only He can do. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You come as God leads.
By Savior.
abide.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Thank you for being here today. I hope you've been challenged and encouraged. Looking forward to our revival services. Don't forget tonight at 6 p.m. This will give you time to go home and get some lunch, get you a good nap, and then come back, because you do not want to miss the night. If you've never heard the sound before, they're going to be here. It's a father and two sons sing a lot of acoustic music. They are phenomenal. You're going to be blessed. You're going to be encouraged. So go get you some lunch and a nap, and then come back early and be a part of that. It'll be at 6 o'clock this evening. Also, this coming Wednesday night, Marty Dupree will be here. We've been going through on Wednesday nights a study called Creating a Culture of Evangelism. Marty has trained in evangelism for many years. He's going to be sharing this coming Wednesday night at 6:30, right here in the sanctuary, conversational evangelism. So this is just using everyday, ordinary conversations to share the gospel. You'll be encouraged. Marty is a wonderful person that loves the Lord and has a heart to share the gospel with other people. So hope you'll be a part of that. And then next Sunday, starting at 8 a.m., Kerry Caldwell will be here. So you'll be praying for him as he comes in on Saturday, and he'll be with us through Wednesday night. Let me also share this, because I'm super excited about it. Lots of times when we think about church events, we think about big events. And that's good to have big events like our Easter Fun Day. Praise the Lord for that. A great turnout for that. Our Fall Festival, great time for that. But thanks to Tammy Taylor and our local missions and ministry committee, we went out into one of the neighborhoods yesterday and were able to love on kids and just do crafts and play games and just have a good time. Almost got blown away. The tent, I thought the tent was going to go flying through the air, but we managed to salvage the tent. But here's the good news. We had a lady there pray to receive Christ. And praise God for that. That's what it's all about, right? We want to meet people where they are. So I'm thankful for that. Be looking for opportunities in the future to be able to serve in those areas. But I'm thankful for what God is doing in the hearts and the lives of people here at Piney Grove. And I'm thankful for you. I love you and hope you have a great day. Pastor Jack, will you close us in prayer?
Thank you, Pastor Brad. If you were blessed by that message and the music today, express to those your appreciation for how God has used them. Let's pray together. Holy Father, we want to thank you that in the fullness of time you sent Jesus, your only begotten Son, to the world to die for the sins of all of us. We thank you for those who are standing here today and worshiping, and they can say, I have been saved. I've been born again. And Lord, for those who may be cold and lukewarm and backslidden, revive them, we pray, from the music and the praise and the time of sharing together today. Lord, direct our paths, bring us back together later this evening, and may this day be a wonderful day in the Lord Jesus, in whose name we pray, and all of God's people said, amen.
Thank you for being a part of this worship service. Our desire is to meet you where you are and help you take the next step in your faith journey. If you have questions about today's message or what it means to follow Jesus, please email me, PastorBradLee@gmail.com. If you have questions about our church or upcoming events, visit our website, pineygrovechapel.org. We look forward to seeing you soon. God bless.